I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the tie that binds, because you're mine. I walk the line.
I'm Mort Cooper, your host on Change Your Voice, Change Your Life. Cures is a dirty word. Cures of what? Of strangled voices, of hopeless voices. I've been reporting cures for over 35 years, at least 15 cures alone at UCLA Medical Center. It's a dirty word. It's a very dirty word. In fact, it's so dirty, the medical profession declines to talk about it. UCLA Medical Center declines to recognize it, and medical profession is not taken with cures of the strangled voice. Let's take a listen to people who've had the strangled voice, the before and after voices, shall we?
If you've ever listened to yourself on tape, then you probably think, I can't believe I sound like that. I've got to change. And the first way most of us want to change is to drop the voice. There are other difficulties that occur with a voice, too. And we're going to talk about one of those with a man who has definitely experienced some difficulties with his voice. He is Pastor James Johnson, and we welcome him to COPE. Hello, Jim.
Good morning, Karen.
I am so glad you're here. Thank you. Thank you for coming down and for being willing to talk with us about your story. Mort, if you will, define spasmodic dysphonia, and then we're going to show a clip of what Jim sounded like. How long ago, Jim?
That was about 8 years ago.
About 8 years ago.
Right.
Okay. What is it?
It's the strangler down here talking like, and the voice comes out. It's like somebody is strangling you.
Yes.
With their hands. And I call it the strangled voice. It's like talking with the brakes on, and there's nothing coming out. And your eyes pop out, and you wonder what's happening to you. It's called spasmodic dysphonia today. It was called spastic dysphonia. It's considered to be hopeless, and I say it has a cure by direct voice rehabilitation, despite what medicine and what speech pathologists say. And I'm a speech pathologist.
Yes, you are.
And I'm trying to tell them, hey, there is a cure and there's a recovery by what I'm doing, but they apparently don't listen and they ignore it.
Right now, our director tells me that we have queued up a tape of your voice prior to the work with Dr. Cooper and some of the way it sounds. Let's roll that tape.
Chronic lupus problem since about 1978, that has been finally diagnosed as being spastic dysphonia as of March of this year. That's what I've been told.
Tell me the history of this problem.
Okay, it first started late in 78 after I had been a large congregation of about 3,000 people alone for a time, and I just was
That makes me tired. I want to help. I want to say,
Right.
Tell us how you felt with that. Now, you are a pastor. That means in my situation, standing up and speaking, under my definition?
Correct. I am a pastor in the Lutheran Church.
Uh-huh.
And, of course, it involves many public functions and
yes.
always standing before people, whether a Sunday morning or a class or a counseling situation,
uh-huh.
and using one's voice.
Yeah.
And it was very tiring to try to struggle with that voice.
I would think not just tiring from a physical standpoint, but emotionally, relationally.
Very much so.
I would also think that some of your parishioners might be hesitant to come to you with a problem because it makes you tired to talk with you like that.
Yes, it really became a barrier between me and people.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you can't communicate, you're cut off from people.
Mm-hmm.
And even though I was in the occupation of working with people, they were hesitant. I know they were.
What about relationships with your family?
Well, with my family, it was a matter of their love that would always carry me through.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, it put a strain on things because we didn't really know if I would need to make a career change.
Mm-hmm. I would think, too, that it would be just difficult to talk with you. Frustrating that perhaps Claudia or your wife would want to finish your sentences for you.
Yes, she would sometimes help me out with that.
Mm-hmm.
Or if we were going through a drive through a fast food place and talk to one of those machines,
mm-hmm.
I could never get an order out. So she would have to yell it out across from me in order
to.
Because I would just choke up and the person there would wonder what's wrong with me.
When did this begin?
It began in 1978.
Uh-huh.
I had been in the ministry about 2 years, serving in a large church of about 3,500 people. And it came on gradually as a hoarseness. I thought it was a bad cold,
mm-hmm.
which never got better and only got worse.
And what all did you do to fix this?
Well, I first tried local speech therapy in our area in various communities. After that did not help, I tried biofeedback, I tried hypnosis, I tried counseling.
Medication?
Vitamins.
Mm-hmm.
People suggested that maybe if you watch a certain diet, take vitamins and supplements,
right.
That might help.
Yeah.
I tried almost anything people suggested.
Of course. I would think so. And then what?
Well, finally, in 1986, I went to Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota.
Mm-hmm.
And there, for the first time, I was given a name to my condition. None of the other people had given a name to it, so mm-hmm. I didn't know what I was struggling with.
And a difficult name.
I bet
they didn't say strangled voice.
No, they called it right away, spasmodic dysphonia.
Mm-hmm.
And they told me there at Mayo that my option was surgery, which would be to sever a nerve in one of the vocal cords,
huh.
and that would stop the spasms. And it may or may not be helpful, they said.
Uh-huh.
And if it wasn't helpful, you were left with a worse voice than before you began.
When you hear that tape, what thoughts go through your mind?
I cringe.
Yes.
It seems so long ago and almost so unreal that I can't, mm-hmm. I forget that I had a voice like that and struggled with it for so long that
mm-hmm.
when I hear it, I go, ooh, yes, it brings back all those emotions.
Did it create spiritual problems for you? Did you ever
yes.
wonder, what are you doing, God?
Yes, very definitely. After struggling with that, I wondered if God was trying to call me in a new direction and trying to make sense out of that,
mm-hmm.
since I felt I'd been called to the ordained ministry.
Finally, what happened?
Well, finally, after I was diagnosed with the condition, I went home to my congregation, and I told them I had good news and bad news.
Mm-hmm.
I said the good news was I had a name for my condition, the bad news was there was no cure. And a few days later, one of my parishioners handed me this book.
Huh.
Dr. Cooper's book, Change Your Voice, Change Your Life. And he said he had read it and that my condition was in there, and Dr. Cooper said he had help. So I read the book and then I contacted him. And
I'll bet, with all due haste.
Yes.
Huh.
And within a few days, Dr. Cooper phoned me, listened
uh-huh.
to my voice, and said if I could give him some time in therapy, he was sure that he could get my voice back.
That was
I tried
really
everything.
An answer
else.
To prayer, wasn't it?
It really was.
Just
it really
essentially
was.
The right moment.
Yes,
this
it was
book
really
shows
at
up
that point.
With your parishioner. That is
correct.
Great. Dr. Cooper, so what did you do from that point on?
I saw James Johnson. He came out and he spent about 50 hours a week for about a month with me. But the
Whoa, wait a minute. 50
hours
a
week. About 10 hours
That's
a day.
That's 10 hours a day.
We intensified therapy.
Well, you really did.
Yeah, the church said they would give me 1 month to work with him,
mm-hmm.
and I could work with him as much as possible. In the book that he showed you, Change Your Voice, Change Your Life, and another book, Winning With Your Voice, I don't say there's help. I said there's a cure for it as well,
mm-hmm.
as well as a recovery. And I've been reporting mm-hmm. cures, which says that these patients are doing something that's wrong. They talk in the lower throat, and medicine says it's a dystonia, D-Y-S-T-O-N-I-A.
Right.
I say it's a dysphonia.
Mm-hmm.
A dystonia is a neurological problem. I say it's wrong use of the voice, and we agree that it's in the lower throat. So a voice comes out like that, and I put his voice up, and he practiced getting the voice around the face, away from the lower throat, with diaphragmatic breathing. And then he got his voice back.
50 hours a week for
mm-hmm.
1 month.
Right.
10 hours a day talking?
Yeah.
Talking. Or at least practicing. And we started out with the mm-hmm sound to help me find the focus,
mm-hmm.
the tone that I needed. Mm-hmm. And
it's a very simple technique.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I've developed that, and I developed the Cooper Instant voice press. So you go, mm-hmm, and the voice goes up around the lips and nose. The mask is where all good and great voices come from.
We're in studio now. Looking back on James Johnson, the Reverend James Johnson, from the Mayo Clinic, took time to persuade Arne Aronson, an icon in my field at the Mayo Clinic, a speech pathologist, to call the Reverend James Johnson after a period of time. It took Arne 20 years to call the minister, and he said he had a perfect voice. He had a perfect voice for, and has had a perfect voice for over 20 plus years. The condition called spasmodic dysphonia, the strangled voice, I report is curable. There are no guarantees, implied or other. It's curable by direct voice rehabilitation. At this point, I have approximately 50 cures of strangled voices, recoveries, additionally, improvements as well. So direct voice rehabilitation, which is all natural, has proven itself for over 35 years, reporting cures, recoveries, and improvements. It took Reverend James Johnson only a few days to decide he's coming out to see me, which I admired, and I now work with patients who have spasmodic dysphonia 25 hours a week. I've figured out how to speed up the therapy, and I like patients who have severe spasmodic dysphonia to work with me for approximately a month. There are those who find a cure in a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and 4 weeks, as well as those who do not find any help because for one reason or another, they simply don't follow directions. The key to a possible cure or a recovery or an improvement is full cooperation with the patients. We have other people who are cured of spasmodic dysphonia that I'm going to run for you on this program. My take is that cures is a dirty word. I just was up at UC San Francisco October 17th and 18th of this year, 2008, and it just appears to me that cures is a dirty word to those who hear it, speech pathologists, ear, nose, and throat doctors, neurologists. The medical profession, one and all basically today, says there are no cures guaranteed in writing. My academic field, the American Speech Language Hearing Association, guarantees in writing there are no cures. And the drug maker, Botox, Allergan, guarantees in writing, not only itself, but through its NSDA funding, basically that organization, there are no cures for the condition. Let's take a listen to a different view. Cures is a dirty word.
They said that it was neurological, something I was born with, and nobody really knew anything about it.
And their suggestion was?
To either try speech pathology or take Botox shots, and I didn't want to take Botox shots. So
I told
I thought
you there's no other approach to it.
Dr. Kremer and to Dr. Robertson's knowledge. She didn't know of any other way either.
Robertson is an MA master's.
Okay. Well, Jan Robertson.
How old is Jan Robertson?
40.
Mm-hmm. They didn't give you an option? Just told you Botox?
Botox or speech pathology.
In the ongoing segment, you'll hear that she tried speech pathology. Speech pathology, like Botox, is coping with the problem. It is not curative. There are no approaches other than direct voice rehabilitation that report a single cure of the condition that I know of in the world. The condition was first described by Traub in 1871 as nervous hoarseness. Psychiatric care failed. Neurological care fails to uncover the cause of the problem. And let's take a listen to the young lady now describing in midterms, and I'm uncovering how to get the normal voice back so simply that it seems mind-boggling. The condition is said to be a dystonia, which means that you cannot change the condition. It's hopeless, incurable, and it's a dystonia, which means forget it, it's all over. Let's take a listen to whether that medical approach and medical theory is accurate.
When the sunlight strikes raindrops in the air, they act like a prism, an form a rainbow. The rainbow is a division of white light into many beautiful colors. These take the shape with its path high above, and its two ends apparently beyond the horizon. There is, according to the legend, a boiling point of gold at one end. People look, but no one ever finds it. When a man looks for something beyond his reach, his friends say he is looking for the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow.
You say A?
A.
E.
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 I.
I.
O.
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 A.
A.
E.
E.
A.
A. A. E. I. O. U. R. E.
A. E. I. O. U. R. E. It's hard for me to find a good job, and it's hard for me to communicate with those when I do have a job. People think I'm sick or I'm crying.
You ever have a pet?
Yes. When I was in middle school, it was a rabbit.
How do you talk with a rabbit?
Tenderly.
Can you talk with a rabbit?
Yeah.
How do you talk to a rabbit? Affectionately? Lovingly?
Yeah.
Let me hear you talk with a rabbit.
Hi, Q-tip.
Go on.
Do you want a carrot today? How come you picked through the celery and just ate the carrots?
What was the rabbit's name?
Q-tip.
Q-tip?
Mm-hmm.
Why did you name the rabbit Q-tip?
Because I couldn't think of any name, and my sister and I were joking around about how many people call the rabbits cotton tail, and I just said, oh yeah, wouldn't that be fun if I called it Q-tip? So we just called it Q-tip.
Can you talk with the rabbit again?
Hi, Q-tip, how are you? Do you want to hop around today? Are you thirsty? Why did you bite my shoe?
Do you realize you change your voice when you talk to the rabbit?
Yes, I talked higher.
It's interesting because it's simple enough to ask people if they have a pet, how do they talk with their pet?
When they're talking to my pet.
And they're told that their problem is neurological, a dystonia, a medical problem, unknown cause, and they cannot change their voice for the better. That fascinates me because I don't agree with the medical model that it's a dystonia or a medical problem. If you realize in your mind, listening to this young lady, she says, mm-hmm, and I developed that technique, she, mm-hmm, it goes right to the face where all good and natural voices are. You simply have to ask the patient with the strangled voice considered hopeless to say, mm-hmm, or to hum the first bar of Happy Birthday, mm-hmm, 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 and the voice changes from the lower throat where all strangled voices remain. And the medical community and I agree on that. It's always in the lower throat to the face when they talk with a pet or talk in a second language. And basically they go up to the face, which indicates it can't be a medical problem, a dystonia. Let's take a listen to the clear voice now, which could be achieved in the first meeting. Who diagnosed it?
Scripps Hospital in La Jolla. Probably about a year and a half ago. They told me that it was neurological and I was born with it.
And what was the treatment?
Botox shots or speech therapy. And I ended up getting very frustrated.
What did they tell you in speech therapy?
That the best thing to do is to take Botox shots.
And what did I tell you to do when you first came in?
To talk to my rabbit and to breathe.
Why did I tell you to talk with your rabbit?
Because usually when people talk to you like babies or animals, they talk higher. And my voice came out clearly. Sometimes I forget, you know, but I just have to remember to keep it high, to breathe.
What do you think about this voice, the one you're using?
I felt it was too feminine and prissy almost, too high for me. But it's completely clear.
We're back in studio. This young lady has remained cured of the condition called spasmodic dysphonia, diagnosed at the Scripps Medical Center on the medical chart by the ear, nose, and throat doctor. Incurable. Incurable? Not so. This young lady has been cured for over 10 years by direct voice rehabilitation. Let's move on and see if we can encounter another spasmodic dysphonic condition.
I'm an old figure.
Okay, how long have you had this condition?
A year and a half.
Okay, was it sudden onset or gradual? What do you do?
We're trainers for Herbalife International. Ronald Steger.
Okay, how long have you had this condition?
A year and a half.
Okay, was it sudden onset or gradual? What do you do?
We're trainers for Herbalife International.
And now we're going to take a listen to his story. He was not happy with his treatment, and you're going to hear a mid-level treatment that he describes his condition with direct voice rehabilitation, and then we'll wind up by explaining that he has a normal voice, and he says so, and he finds he's cured of the condition called spasmodic dysphonia. Let's take the mid-level treatment.
My first consultation, he taped me like he did here, and he diagnosed me with spasmodic dysphonia, and he gave me three choices. One, Botox shots, two, surgery, three, live with it. And I decided to try the Botox because he highly recommended that. It helps a lot of his patients get rid of their spasms in their neck. Mm-hmm. I would be real breathy for like 6 weeks where I could just whisper, like, hello, how is it out there? And I still had a hard time talking. What's that?
Did you have to take deep breaths to get your voice?
Yes, I had to take a deep breath, even to whisper.
Mm-hmm. And because then, the vocal cords were paralyzed and the air was going through.
Yeah.
And then did you get a normal voice or did you get some
Then
voice?
I would get a almost normal voice, but it was not like it is now. Mm-hmm. And then I would go right back to the way I sound on that tape, back to spasms, and I have to go back in for more shots.
Where were the doctors? Where are the medical centers?
The first one I seen was Milwaukee, Frederick Medical College, mm-hmm. Dr. Albert
Marotti. A great medical center?
Yes.
Who was the doctor?
Dr. Albert Marotti. He had all this medical equipment, an arm full of doctors, white coats, I believed him. When he told me this is for life, there's no known cure, there's Botox, surgery, or live with it, I believed him. And then I went to another clinic because I wasn't satisfied with the results I was getting with him for 6 months, so I went to Minnesota, the Mayo Clinic in Minnesota, and I seen Nicholas Margos, and he looked at me and evaluated me and said the same thing, spasmodic dysphonia, surgery, Botox, or live with it, Ron.
This young man had 5 Botox shots, and he was not happy. None of them were doing the job for him. Despite the fact that Botox is said to be 99% effective, I don't believe that from clinical experience. They're well-intentioned to say that. The medics tell the patients that Botox is a state-of-the-art treatment of choice. They sometimes forget to ask for whom it is the treatment of choice and for whom it is the art. So here you heard a young man who had a pretty good voice, and you wouldn't suspect that he had spasmodic dysphonia. But that was midterm, and now let's take a listen to his voice as he's describing how he feels now.
And he says, well, Ron, I'll give you 3 options, too. He says, well, you can continue coming here for shots. You can call that doctor in California to schedule a surgery if you'd like. And then he goes, oh, by the way, Ron, there's also this other guy go to his website, and he wrote down his name, thevoicedoctor.com, and handed it to him, and he says, check out this guy. He says he has a cure. And go home and let me know what you decide to do. Think about it, he said, before you apply that surgery. So I went home, went to the voice doctor right away, because here's somebody that he said that has a natural cure for it. And I go to his website, and here there's 14, 15, maybe more than that now, testimonies, people with spasmodic dysphonia. And then after a year, or some people 6 months, of direct voice rehabilitation, and they're talking. And they sound just like me, you know, can't count from 1 to 10, can't say your name. And here they are after seeing Dr. Horton Cooper, they're talking. Once I understood how to start using my voice correctly and breathing correctly, my voice started coming back to me. And it's amazing. I mean, I couldn't believe it. And I stayed with him a week and went home. He had diagnostic sentences for me, voice exercises, breathing, and a schedule, start in the morning, afternoon, evening, continually do these voice exercises until it's better. And it's amazing. Here I am today, talking normally. I go to church, I can sing, and it's amazing. Besides having surgery and Botox shots, it's a great option. I'm glad I went to him and found a cure for my voice, a natural cure. And it's great being able to talk. And I'd like to thank you again, Dr. Cooper, for what you do for society. And so I'm very thankful for you. And God's blessing for you. And it's amazing talking normal. And I can't say enough how much I love wanting to help someone else find their path or journey to getting a corrective voice. It's fantastic.
We're back in studio. Cures is a dirty word. Across the world, across the United States, at UCLA Medical Center, UCLA Head and Neck Division, over 15 cures of those patients diagnosed by the staff and faculty. We're listening to Johnny Cash. Thank you for joining with me. I'm Mort Cooper. Bye-bye.